For NPR Music, you're connected to All Songs Considered. I'm Bob Boylan.
And I'm Robin Hilton. Few bands ever reached the level of popularity, influence, and status as the band Nirvana. Anyone who's old enough to remember knows that the trio from Aberdeen, Washington, helped pioneer and popularize grunge rock. But more than that, Nirvana became a symbol for an entire generation, from fashion and art to the way teens and 20-year-olds were making sense of the world back in the early 1990s.
Remarkably, Nirvana did all this in a very short burst of time, from about 1987 to 1994, and just three studio albums to their name. The last one they released, In Utero, happened 20 years ago and was recorded about a year before the band's singer Kurt Cobain took his own life. In Utero is being reissued with some remarkable additions. There's a remastered version of the original record, a remixed version, a DVD, a disc of live recordings, a bunch of previously unreleased demos, and tons of photos and liner notes.
Bob and I spoke with Nirvana's two surviving members, drummer Dave Grohl and bassist Krist Novoselic, about In Utero and about recording a record with their hero, Steve Albini. They share their memories of being in the studio, of setting their hair on fire, and making a great raw record. We begin with Dave Grohl, who talked about the music he was listening to back when Nirvana was headed to Minnesota to record In Utero.
Well, let's see. In 1993, I was listening to a lot of the Jesus Lizard, which was a great band that Steve Albini also produced. I think I was also listening to that last Pixies album, or there was maybe the first Frank Black solo record had come out around that time too.
Maybe if you pick something off the Jesus Lizard, since it's a Steve Albini production, maybe we can talk about something in the sound that attracted you.
I gotta say, Steve Albini was really famous for his signature sound, the sound that he got on his albums. It was no accident. There's a science to what he does, and it was usually mostly recognized in the drums. So if you listen to the Breeders' first album, Pod, or you listen to the Pixies' Surfer Rosa, or you listen to the Jesus Lizard album, Liar, it sounds like a band in a room, but there's some sort of sonic element to it that nobody else could get than Steve Albini. He was the only guy that could get that drum sound.
Let's listen to some of it. Because we'll hear some on the In Utero. Let's listen to some of the Jesus Lizard and hear the drums, and then we can talk about the specifics and how he did it and stuff.
There's a song called Boilermaker, which is I think is the first song off of the Liar album, maybe.
All right, let's play some of that. I'm going to repeat. I'll pull your mics out at this moment for just a moment. You really do feel, I mean, especially coming off of drum sounds from the 1980s that were monstrously compressed and in your face, you really do get a sense of a big, open, spacious thing going on drums here. And we'll play some of In Utero a little bit here that as well. Would that be a good characterization of the difference there?
Yeah, I think so. You know, I remember when we were making In Utero, one of the things that Steve talked about was trying to record or mix or equalize the sound of a band in a way that seemed natural. So without the vocals seeming disconnected from the music, like, I think what he tried to do was present the song to the listener in a way that sounded entirely real, you know? But he would kind of embellish things in a way that made it more powerful. And he's just, you know, he's a brilliant dude. And going to make that record with him, I mean, he was like, I remember taking the Breeders' first album, Pod, down to Sound City when we were making the album Nevermind and saying, oh, this is the drum sound. Like, that's the sound. We love that sound. It's a great sound. That was always, I don't know, it was something that we always loved or related to, was was Steve Albini recordings.
Did you feel disappointed when for the drum sound on Nevermind?
No, dude, that record sounds great.
Okay. Because it sounds very different. But it doesn't sound like Steve Albini's sound. I mean, that kick drum is... There's heavy compression on it. It's really a different sound than the Albini sound. So that's why I asked.
Well, you know, it's one of the great things about the luxury of recording in different places with different people is that you get to experience all of those different, their technique or their sound. And recording with Butch was a lot different than Steve. You know, with Butch, we would do multiple takes and we would like try to get things to sound. We would like really craft these things. Whereas with Steve, I swear, we would do one take and he'd hit stop and say, okay, what's next?
You know, we had to prove ourselves to Steve. So on the first day at the studio, we're all set up and we're ready to go. And like, okay, Steve, we're rolling right. He goes, we're rolling. And so we play the song Serve the Servants. And, you know, Dave counts us in and just goes, bam, the song starts, okay. And then we play the song, and then of course the ending falls apart, and like every song on In Utero. And so we finish the song, and so Kurt and Dave and I, we look at each other, and we're like, well, yeah, that felt pretty good. It's like, how was it, Steve? He's like, sounds good. Like, we're all right. We're gonna do another song. So like one take, and so that way we won Steve over after that.
That's fabulous. We should just listen to the top cut, the first cut of In Utero, just. Hear those drums that we were talking about and get the feel of what it was like to be at Pachyderm Studios in Minnesota in February of 1993. Sounds so good. So to so many people who don't know about recording and don't know about technique, the idea is what's so complicated about throwing a band in a room and just recording them? And of course, as you know, it presents all sorts of problems when everybody's in the same room, and that's the untangling that needs to get done to make it so a band can perform together in a room, but to be able to record it so everything doesn't turn to mush, right? Isn't that the mega problem that
I think so. I mean, it depends on what you want to do, but for the noise that we made when we were in a room, isolation and separation was usually a good idea. You know, if you put the three of us in a room full of microphones and hit go, it would just sound like, you know, but you know, I remember that room. It was such a beautiful place to record too. Like, if you've ever seen pictures of the house or the studio, you know, I'm sure it's a beautiful place to hang out in the summertime. And unfortunately, we were there in February. It's outside of Minneapolis. It was like sub-zero Arctic temperature. But that room where we recorded the stuff, the room sounded great, and it was a comfortable place to be. And I remember sitting at my drums, and Kurt was to my left, and Chris was to my right. And we had a proper isolation, and we would track live together.
So when describe what it means for proper isolation to somebody who doesn't understand what that means. Is it a big foam? Is it glass?
Well,
is it what's between you and him?
They were probably just like some sort of baffles.
It was a sliding glass door between you and the bass amp. Right. But I stood on your side of the sliding glass.
Yeah, you were
because I
room.
Wanted to feel the kick drum like in my chest.
Power.
I wanted to feel
heart,
the power.
Your mind, soul.
That's it.
That was it. Yeah. I mean, you know, when you're recording multiple instruments in a room with multiple microphones, the sound of the room is bleeding into each microphone. And if, you know, say you have a microphone that's pointed at a snare drum or is pointed at a singer's mouth, you want to try to contain or isolate those specific microphones so that not everything is bleeding into those, if that makes any sense. So, but you do want to be in the room with each other so that you can get the vibe of playing with that person, you know?
And Steve Albini has these strategies, and they're rather sophisticated, about where you place the microphone in the room and how you put it in one place. And he doesn't really use any type of like equipment. He calls it synthetic or reverb and this and that, because he wants the real thing. And so it's very organic, non-GMO organic, no pesticides, labor friendly junk food.
Right. Now, there was a moment before you got there that was it the band, Robin? You've got the letter. The box set has all this stuff, and I'm going to let Robin.
Yeah, let's just talk about it real quickly. There's a remastered version of the original album. It's been remixed. Steve Albini remixed it for this edition. Tons of demos, previously unreleased tracks, a disc of live cuts, a DVD, and there really are some amazing liner notes. And it includes a 5-page letter that Steve Albini wrote you guys before you even got into the studio with him. And I can just read the opening graph from him. It's a single typed 5-page letter. He says, "I think the very best thing you could do at this point is exactly what you're talking about doing. Bang a record out in a couple of days with high quality but minimal production, no interference from the front office bullet heads. If that is indeed what you want to do, I would love to be involved." And then he closes by saying, "If a record takes more than a week to make, somebody's fucking up." So you guys did this, I think, in 2 weeks, yeah?
But we didn't screw up, though. We mixed. We recorded and mixed in 2 weeks. And we moseyed along, though. But, you know, we were well prepared. I mean, we developed a work ethic. We had a great work ethic. We would rehearse a lot. And, you know, we were coming in and blasting out songs in one take, three takes the most.
The remixed versions, I'm really curious to hear what you think of these newly remixed versions that Steve did for this release. I'm really hearing a lot of things I'd never heard before, little details like he added Kurt's voice to the top of Serve the Servants. On Dumb, I noticed Dumb loses most of the string parts, the cello part under most of Dumb. It comes in at the end, but it's not throughout the body of the song. I'm wondering if you saw these remixes as a chance to either fix things you weren't happy with, or just a chance to sort of reimagine how it could all sound.
In Utero, with the remixes, just breathes a little more now. It was a little squished sounding, I thought. Well, it's remastered now. The original's remastered.
Tell people what that means, because that's always complicated for people to understand.
When you remaster something, and it was remastered at Abbey Road in London. And so when you record a record and there's like different levels and frequencies on each individual track. And so when you master a record, you give it some uniformity, or it doesn't like blow somebody's speakers. One song's super loud, the next one's super quiet or whatever. It just kind of evens out, and you put some EQ on things. And so that's what mastering is. But we went one step beyond that, and we remixed the record. And so it was on multi-tracks, and it was not done on a computer. There's no clicking or dragging or command V, command C, or we weren't on hold with the service people in Mumbai, India. Oh no, it's crashed again. It was all done on tape. And that, again, that's Steve's way. And it was all set up in the recording. And so the way those microphones were stationed around the room, and we were listening to each individual track. And so like on Serve the Servants, there was it was listed on the track sheet, guitar two. And it's like, whoa, we never used this in the mix we did. And so we listened to it. And so on the remix version, there's a different guitar solo. And we worked with like some vocals that, you know, just kind of freshen it up. And I listened to The Doors. There was a Doors anthology remix, The Future Starts Now, I think it's called, where they remix the songs. And it was, that's where I got the idea. I go, well, the doors sound all nice and fresh for the 21st century. And it's 20 year anniversary of In Utero. So it'd be a good time to try something similar.
So did you approach him to do the remixes? Is that?
Absolutely. The man. We went to the man, Steve.
Straight to the source.
We went to his studio, Electrical Audio in Chicago.
He wears a jumpsuit when he works.
What color?
Blue. Well, it's sort of like a grayish. It looked like maybe it was cobalt at one point, but it faded in the wash. I'm not sure. It was a onesie. He works in a onesie.
It's OSHA. The place is OSHA approved. It's super safe environment.
Yeah.
It's
he also serves that kind of coffee that those weird lemurs, when they eat the beans and then poop them out, and they're very expensive, and you make coffee with them. They're good too.
Cobalt is like a really happening color now. If you like, all the new cars have like some shade of cobalt, or yeah, kind of a smoked
or Pelham purple. Blue. That's a nice blue too.
That's a nice shade too. He's into textures. Steve is into textures.
So you guys were sitting in on the remixes then. You were with Steve when he did them.
Absolutely. Well, he would have it no other way. He wouldn't remix a record without a band there.
Yeah.
Let's walk through that we're back in Minnesota, and we're in February, and it's 93. You'd knock out a couple of songs in a day. Did you then go ahead and try to mix some of those, or was everything just performance, and then?
We finished the drums in the first maybe 3 or 4 days. Then I think maybe after that was bass and guitar stuff if you needed to.
I maybe changed a few things here and there on the bass. Then it was Kurt, and he did his vocals. And
wait a minute, I'm confused about something, because we just talked about the fact that the band was in the same room at the same time playing music, and now you're telling me that. So explain that. You're telling me that people are doing parts separately. Oh, you do the drums and
right.
So explain.
Well, now usually what you do is there's basic tracks and then there's overdubs, and so a basic track would be Chris, Kurt, and I in the same room, and we would lay down the guitar, bass, and drums in one take, and then you'd move on to the next song. So after you've done 13 basic tracks, then you go back and you listen and you think, does this need an extra guitar part? Does this need percussion? Does this need? And then you start overdubbing things, and if there's anything that you need to redo or fix, then you can do that as well. But you know, recording with Steve, there's minimal overdubbing and there's minimal like fixes, and there's hardly any like percussion or anything on the record. It's really a really simple recording. So then it was just a matter of Kurt going in and singing all of the songs and putting harmonies on, and I don't even know if he had all of his lyrics. I remember there were some days where like nothing would happen for hours, and we'd just sort of be sitting waiting for something to go down, you know.
There was no auto-tune. There was no auto-tune.
You know what I remember?
No comp tracks.
There was this stuff that they used to clean the tape heads in the studio, and it was like pure alcohol and incredibly flammable. And so we started doing things like pouring it on someone's leg and lighting their leg on fire.
Oh, that's fun.
Pouring it on someone's boot. And I poured some on my head.
Flaming cymbals are so cool.
Ooh.
Ask Gibby.
Yeah.
Yeah,
that
so
was
there
not
was a
OSHA.
Lot of time spent doing absolutely nothing, too.
It's interesting to hear you say that sometimes you were recording and Kurt hadn't even worked out the lyrics yet, because there's some really cool demos in this 20th anniversary set, and most of the demo tracks don't have any lyrics with them at all. And I thought we could play a little bit of All Apologies, the demo for that, because it sounds like Kurt's still trying to work out the lyrics on it. Can we just hear a little bit of that?
sounds like they didn't even have his vocal mic on. He was just somewhere in some room or nearby an open mic, right?
That was, we found that on a cassette, like the multi-tracks vanished. And so that is not even, we couldn't even mix that.
That's why the tape speed's so odd too.
Yeah, it's just kind of, that's what we got. The re-release is about, you know, those kind of things, those little, fans really like those little chestnuts like that. So
are there any surprises that came out for you in the remixing of these songs? Anything that surprised you in any of the tracks?
No. It was all there. It was so like, it's so straight ahead. It's an old fashioned record in some ways. Like, it was before the internet we made this record, before computers. Again, it's nice to have it breathe a little bit. And so we just pried it open a little bit, and that was the mission, and kind of open the windows and kind of freshen it up.
So you spend like 2 weeks in Minnesota, you do these recordings, you come home, and everybody seemed pretty happy when they walked out the door, right?
I think so.
We were out of the woods of Minnesota.
Yeah, we were happy to be the hell out of there.
Because we were from Washington. Western Washington has a mild climate. We're just not used to that, those cold temperatures.
You know what I remember? I remember that there was this sock that Steve had stuffed with mashed potatoes.
I'm sorry, you said sock, S-O-C-K?
Yeah, there was a sock that Steve had stuffed with mashed potatoes from dinner one night, and it was going back and forth from, I put it under his pillow at night, or then maybe like it would wind up on my drum stool the next day, and then it would wind, and when I got home, I opened up my suitcase, and that sock full of mashed potatoes was in there.
That's a beautiful love message, I'd say.
You know, he and I really hit it off.
The winter that was. So you come home. Do you come home with tapes?
We came home with cassettes. And we had this really raw, intense record. And then the conversation started regarding the obligations of being a number one band on the radio and on the charts.
And those conversations are with who?
With like label people and the people who deal with those things, those matters. And so we decided we'd pick the songs. Like, we could hear singles on the record for the radio. And then a few months before we did In Utero, REM were in Seattle and they recorded Automatic for the People. And so I'd go down there and say hi, and you know, they'd be wrapping up things and like they'd play me a song. Like, I heard Man on the Moon right off the press. I'm like, Michael, are you gonna keep the yeah yeah yeahs? He's like, absolutely. I'm like, really good. And then so we decided that maybe because of our obligations as a professional rock band and as unit shifters, we remixed the songs with Scott Litt, who recorded Automatic for the People and other REM work. So we had a little more work to do on the record.
First of all, did you play these cassettes for the label, or did the label get more proper copies to listen to?
I don't remember what they got. That was before CDs. They probably got a DAT.
Right.
They got a DAT tape.
Yeah, maybe a DAT. Was the reaction both from you and from them, hey, we need more singly stuff, or this was not well received, right? I mean, I wouldn't be wrong to say this wasn't completely well received.
Well, we weren't going to do a song like Milk It be the first single, okay?
Yeah.
Yeah, and so it was like people have their roles, and they're, you know, then again, these are, I call them the obligations of being like the number one rock band. And so we worked our way through it, and part of the solution was working with Scott Litt.
Well, how'd Steve feel about that?
I think he was kind of pissed.
I think so.
I would think so. I mean, yeah. You go in there with this philosophy to do this one thing, and you walk out the door, and then you go in with the people he tried to keep away from you, the record label, what bullet heads, I think he used.
Are you saying we were conflicted? Is that what you're trying to tell us?
Yeah, I don't know if you've thought about this.
I've thought about it more than you. I've thought about it a lot.
Yeah, no, of course. And was that just this tear inside of all of you, or did some feel more than others that A, the obligation and or the in some ways you were running from the obligation and the rawness that you walked out the door of Albini's place with, right?
Well, we weren't necessarily running from it, but you know, we were, you got to be rational. It's like, okay, we could make this, if it's going to work on the record or it's going to work on the radio, you know, we signed the deal, and a lot of bands were like fiercely independent, never even signed on a major label. Well, we were there already, so we don't, you know, weren't really running away from it. It was a solution and it was a viable one.
Mm-hmm. The 20th anniversary presents us with, let's say, a version of All Apologies that was the Albini mix, right? And the mix that we are also familiar with is not his mix, correct?
Correct.
And so could we just play, because I think in people's minds, they know those vocals, which sound doubled. Did they? Is that one of the things that got done after Albini on All Apologies? Kurt sang on top of himself, so to speak?
He added some background vocals, because I remember I went to his house and he's walking down the stairs and he goes, check out these background vocals for Heart-Shaped Box. And like, well, that sounds cool. And so when you know, I guess we're still working on the record at his house. It just made sense to go in and remix it.
How about if I play a little bit of the original Albini version of, would Heart-Shaped Box be one of the tunes we're talking
yes.
about?
Yes, yeah. Let's
and,
do
and,
it.
And let's... So what do you all hear is the big difference when you listen to this version?
Well, you know, when we were remixing the song at those songs at Steve's studio, Electrical, it's been 20 years since we made that album, and I think in that time, Steve has gotten better at what he does. And you know, when we were sitting there listening to the basic rough tracks, the recordings that we had done, you hear a sound that you don't necessarily like hear anymore. You know, when a lot of modern recordings just don't hold that same sort of weight that Steve got then and can still get now. And like, you know, it's a weird thing when you isolate tracks of something that you recorded a really long time ago.
Meaning that when you're listening back and the multi-track is playing, he hits a solo button and you just hear that one instrument in isolation from everything else.
Yeah, or like a vocal mic that is just, you could just hear someone breathing in the room, you know, like it's a real, it's a sonic document of a moment in time, and you listen to it back and it really brings you back to that place. Like, it's one of the funny things about this whole experience of this re-release and all of this, you know, nostalgia or retrospect or whatever it is, like that time might seem a little blurry, but you remember the feeling of being there, you know? And it was one of the reasons why Steve was the perfect person to make that record, because that's kind of what he did. Like, he was not into manipulating moments. He was into like capturing them. So when I listen back to this stuff, it's like, it makes me sort of feel the way I felt then, because it's so real, you know. And I just think about, I think about us being kids, like we were kids. It's so crazy that we were going through all of this stuff and these real sort of like formative years. And this album was such a, was a transition for us too. Like I have an emotional reaction to this record. I don't listen to it like I'm listening to, you know, Saturday Night Fever. Like I have, kind of a more emotional reaction to it because it's really raw and it's really real. So as we were remixing these things, it was even more so like, wow, well now you can, you know, you can just listen to Kurt's vocal or you can just listen to Chris's bass. And it's like, you know, it really sort of breaks those memories into all of these different pieces that are very defined and specific, you know?
I remember with Heart-Shaped Box in the studio on that version you just played, there was a long discussion about, and Steve and Kurt had this idea on the solo to just make it very distorted and kind of out there. And I was against it. I'm like, why are you doing this? And I guess it was about the, I was the sellout in the room or whatever. Like we have, you know, this is a beautiful song. It's an epic song. Like, why do you want to kind of.
I remember that too. Remember I that? Felt the same way. I just didn't say anything.
And then it was just like, remember it was like an hour and a half. All these speeches are going down. Yeah. And I'm like, okay, that sounds good. Now don't do it.
Yeah.
Okay. Please. I understand. I completely understand.
I would say delete that.
Yeah. Mute, exactly. Mute. Delete all. Yeah. It was a epic discussion. It's like, why are you doing this?
You are making a career decision, my friend. Yeah, I mean, you know, like looking, it's just at a 24, different time now. You know, well, at 24 years old, I was wearing shorts with long johns underneath them. You know, what did I know? You know,
making career decisions, Jess. lighting fires on your pants.
I was changing the face of popular fashion with my long johns and high tops.
I was a mature 28. I was a 28-year-old.
Yeah, you're the old guy.
Yeah, he was the elder statesman of the band.
The elder statesman. Fellas, do it my way or the highway.
How old was Albini? Was he your
He's
peer?
Our age. I think so.
Well, you know, he was one of our heroes, man. Like, that was a big deal to be able to make a record with them. Like, you know, I had big black records and I loved Surfer Rosa. Like, to make a record with them was a really big deal. And I admit that when we walked in there, I was terrified and intimidated because his reputation was that of like a really like cynical, opinionated. Like, I'd heard stories that bands would send them their single and ask him to do their next record, and he would smash it and send it back with no letter and stuff like that. Like, oh my God, he's, you know, he's like the General Kurtz of the music industry. This is crazy. He's gone too far up the river and he's lost it, man. And you know, we get there and he's like a pussycat. He's the sweetest person in the world, and we had a blast. He and I got along really well because we're both kind of goofs. But I remember, at one point, I had taken that tape cleaner and poured it on my leg as he was taking a nap on a couch. And I lit my leg on fire and ran in there and woke him up with my leg on fire. And I said, Steve, there's something wrong in the studio. And we had a laugh and he went back to sleep and I went back in the control room. And then I poured some on my hat and I lit my hat on fire and put it on top of my head. And I ran in there with my head on fire. Steve, there's something wrong in the... And before I could finish saying that, my hair started kind of... I could hear my hair burning.
There's that bad smell.
Sizzling and that smell. So I take my hat off and I stamp it out in the ground and he's looking at me like, you idiot. And
the
so
horror.
The horror. And I nailed it to the wall and put a little piece of tape and just wrote dumb on it and just had a burnt hat that said dumb on the wall. And I came back 15 minutes later and he had changed that piece of tape to say drummer.
Perfect. Were there a lot of drugs and alcohol in the studio? I mean, I'm just, besides the alcohol no, to clean the...
No.
What is this, behind the music? Come on, guys. Go to the road.
I don't remember not even a beer or pot, nothing.
I had stopped smoking pot in like 1990. So
there
I was kind of...
nothing.
I was a sober guy. Plus, you know, where the hell are you going to get weed in the middle of winter outside of Minneapolis? You know what I mean? We weren't making the record at Tough Gong. No, yeah, I mean, we were focused. That's the funny thing is I think that maybe the reputation that Nirvana has is that we were like three Sid Vicious's.
Vicious?
Is that what it is? Vicious.
It was kind of a family atmosphere. You know that Court. It was a family. It was a family atmosphere. So like, Courtney came over with Francis, and then Courtney wanted to add to the family atmosphere, and then she wanted to bake us a roast. Remember? And we're like, oh no. So I think we unplugged the stove and said it was broken. Like, oh, the stove doesn't work.
Well, you already had the mashed potatoes.
Yeah, but it was nice, and it was.
Yeah, but those were in my suitcase.
Yeah.
I got a note last night. I don't know if you know. Do you know the musician Dan Deacon at all, by chance?
I don't know.
He lives in Baltimore. He does electronic, great community-oriented electronic music, big parties around the Green Skull and his craziness. Anyway, Dan Deacon sent me a note last night. It made me think of what you were talking about, which was that he said, why don't you guys release the stems, the original tracks of each of the record, because people can learn so much from what's on those tracks.
When digital stuff became what everyone uses, people started taking these 2-inch tapes and archiving them digitally so that, you know, the recording will last forever. The tape might disappear, but you download it into a computer and that will last forever. So in doing that, all of a sudden on YouTube, you started getting the isolated tracks like Freddie Mercury's vocal track from Under Pressure. And it's just his vocal, or like Paul McCartney's bass line from Hey Bulldog, and it's just his bass line, and it's amazing, man. Like, any studio dork like me has spent countless hours listening to, like, you know, the bass track from Def Leppard's Hysteria or something, you know, just wasting valuable memory space in my brain listening to these things that you otherwise would never hear. And it's really, really, really cool because you hear things that you otherwise might not have ever heard. Like, and it's
bass line from Bohemian Rhapsody. I've done it. It's on YouTube.
For sure, man.
There's Nirvana stems.
Oh, Killer Queen. Have you ever listened to the drums from that?
No.
I mean, you listen to it, you're like, oh my God, they decided that they were going to keep that. You know, it's just raw. It's great. I mean, it's and one of the great things about it is, you know, one of the reasons why an album like In Utero still sounds fresh today is because it's the sound of three people. Like, it really is. There's imperfection and inconsistency. You know, we didn't scrub it up and polish it and clean it up and hand it to you. We recorded it sometimes only once and then decided that's what you needed to hear because it's real in that way. And I think that, you know, when I hear a song from In Utero on the radio in between maybe other modern popular recordings, it really stands out, you know, because it sounds like us. And the only people that sounded like us were us, you know. That's the way a musician should be. A musician should only sound like what they do. And you can't, no two musicians sound the same. It's like an individual feel thing, you know. And it's one of the greatest things about that record. Like, we totally achieved what I think we wanted to do. There was an integrity in our band that we wanted things to be real, you know, honest and real. And that's, In Utero is entirely that.
In Utero is a testament to the artistic vision of Kurt Cobain and how it's kind of a weird record, but it's strangely beautiful at the same time. And if you look at Kurt's like paintings and his drawings, and he even did a sculpture for me. I have this little this writhing, tortured spirit person. It's weird, you know, but it's done well. And so that was Kurt's, he had his own, it's like what Dave was saying about having your own sound. And, you know, Kurt was a great songwriter. He knew, he had a good ear for a hook, great singer, great guitar player. And, you know, In Utero is a good representation of what he liked in art and how he expressed himself.
That's beautiful. Do you want anything to add to that?
I feel like that's a good point to let you guys go. I did want to ask you about some of these previously unreleased cuts. What can you tell us about the Forgotten Tune demo?
Well, Forgotten Tune was, we found it and like, what is this song? And like, I don't really remember. And so, well, what do you want to call it? And I'm like, oh, I don't want to give it a name because I don't want to, like, you know, give it say something. So let's just call it Forgotten Tune and let people make up their own minds like what it is. But I remember the main riff in that tune. I think it was from like 1988 or something. It was just trying to, you know, bringing back a riff. And some of those, you know, like All Apologies was from 1990. Dumb was a pre Nevermind song. Penny Royal Tea. You and Kurt were getting crazy some night down in that apartment with a cassette, multi-track cassette recorder. Penny Royal Tea came out of that. And so there were new songs, and we were trying to, you know, revisit old ideas and seeing what we can keep working on them, tune them in. And that new or forgotten tune or whatever just represents that idea. Let's see if we can make something out of this.
So let's go out on that. We'll go out on the forgotten tune. And so the 30th anniversary then is going to have the stems of all the songs. You promised that, right?
It'll just be the drums.
I'd buy that.
Dave and Chris, thank you so much. Really appreciate your time.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.